Worth the Risk, the global state of chains. Fasten your seatbelts. An industry expert navigates the cryptocurrency markets for a glimpse into the future of the sector. Brock Pierce, Bitcoin Foundation.
Good morning, Malta. Good to see everyone up in a room full this morning. Where are we going? There we go. And do we have audio? Anyway, I'm going to walk you through kind of state of the chain, state of the union, and then more importantly, talk about where the market is going. But by way of background, I came out of the games business, well, media business, movies originally, digital media after that. But what got me into this space was gaming. If you've ever played things like World of Warcraft or Second Life, I made a market starting back in 1999 all the way through up and until recently for the in-game assets. You know, the gold in World of Warcraft, the Linden dollars in Second Life. And this is back when people were like, why would I ever want to buy digital gold? Why would someone do that? And I'd be like, well, do you play golf? And they'd be like, yeah. I go, well, do you like to play golf with good golf clubs? You know, you want to play on a good course? I go, just because something is intangible doesn't make it any less valuable. If that's how you choose to spend your discretionary time. And this became a very big business. We ended up building a supply chain of about 400,000 people in China that were playing games professionally to mine digital currency that we would sell all over the world. We were PayPal's largest merchant for years. We were Google's largest advertiser for a little while. We helped launch Alipay. So got very deep into the cross-border sort of payments, got very deep into, you know, mining when it was much more complicated before it was automated. It actually required physical labor at one point. But this industry is actually what drove a lot of the user adoption in crypto, something that's lost on many. The reason why China and South Korea are the largest crypto markets in the world is because they were the largest digital currency markets in the world. You didn't have to teach people. You didn't have to go through this experience of human behavior and change. They're like, oh, intangible, speculative, can make money. Got it. We've seen this before. And so that's a big part of where you'll see historical adoption in the space. Really good news, any Game of Thrones fans here, you know, the show is over. And as part of that, winter is over as well. Fortunately, the things that drove this, though, because most people aren't knowing it, I haven't been, when people say, oh, do you think it's a good time to buy? I go, you know, average your way in. But about 3 months ago, I said, no, crypto, winter is over, spring has come early, I see groundhogs everywhere. And the data point that is worth noting is that an association by the name of Cambridge Associates, which is what all the major institutions, the endowments, the pensions, the big insurance companies, this is who they look to determine their asset allocation. And about 3 months ago, they said that every major institution in the world, not just Harvard and Yale and MIT, should have 30 basis points of their assets allocated to this industry, which should drive about $300 billion of investment into the sector, though it'll take years to happen. But this is the thing that's triggering it more than anything else. And other things, just to put sort of numbers into perspective. You know, sometimes we're like, oh, have we missed the opportunity? Just to show us where we are. In the internet bubble of 1999, the tech stocks got to $6.7 trillion. And that was an entirely Western phenomenon. And that number is not inflation adjusted. It's not taking into consideration any of the quantitative easing and other things that have occurred. I could make a compelling argument that that number should have been $50 to $100 trillion. So when we look at our industry at $200 billion today, we haven't even seen the beginning of the first big bubble. These are all just sort of like the pre-quakes. We haven't even seen, you know, the big game. It's all preseason right now. I heard John Matonis mention IEOs, and yes, the ICOs are back, but they're called IEOs, and this is a very good thing. The exchanges are essentially operating as underwriters. In this first wave of ICOs, and I had the pleasure of being one of the founding board members or founders of MasterCoin, where we invented the ICO back in the summer of 2013, they were a little out of hand, and it was where the issuer was essentially marketing directly to the contributor in that token sale. The IEO is where the exchange is jumping into the middle and acting as an underwriter and essentially filtering the projects, limiting the number of projects that are happening, and they're in terms of the size of the offering, limiting the scale of those offerings. So I think this is a much more rational thing. It's allowing innovators to be able to access capital markets to get the resources they need, but in a much more sane fashion. So I think this is a great thing. You've heard about security tokens. These are going to be massive. It's going to still take a while for this to take off, but I'm a huge fan of security tokens. I think we're going to see all the private equity markets, venture markets, hedge fund markets, real estate markets, energy markets, bond markets, all of this stuff will be tokenized. So between these two asset classes, I think we're looking at a quadrillion-dollar market. We're looking at the largest market the world has ever seen. So if you're questioning whether or not you're in the right space at the right time, absolutely. If anything, we're still too early. We're essentially where the internet was in 1995 or 1996. We just now have the bridges, the roads, and the tunnels to start to do the big things. But it's still early. It took till 1999, really, for that to take off. And in terms of real traction, it took until the 2000s. Things are moving a little faster. Banks, I think this is worth noting. So in the year 2007, 2008, when we had the global financial crisis, we talked about the banks becoming too big to fail. This is a data point that's lost on most people, and that is that no new banks have been created since then. Essentially, no new banks. And so the big have gotten even bigger. And this is a huge, huge risk factor. But that's some of the work that we're doing here, right? We have these non-custodial wallets or, you know, non-custodial blockchain-based banks that are coming in to hopefully stabilize and, you know, distribute this infrastructure. And then you also have new sort of 2.0 banks that are lightweight, mobile in nature, one of which just announced a new Puerto Rican bank, the Medici Bank, with Prince Lorenzo de Medici. As I like to say, the Medici started the first bank, and the Medici family is back to start the last bank. Anyway, the internet is broken. The internet as we know it is going to completely go away. When the internet was first being architected, it was... we knew the cryptography that was needed to secure it, but we didn't have the computer processing power at the time, and powers that be didn't want it secure. And this is becoming a major, major problem now that we have state-sponsored hacking. The internet needs to be upgraded. The blockchain is essentially going to be the security layer as part of that new stack, which probably also includes things like 5G, et cetera. But the entire internet, as we know it, is likely to be rebuilt. Again, the opportunity here continues to be massive. Spring is here. Spring is here. And so let's talk a little bit about the future and what to expect in the remainder of 2019. We have scalability. The Generation 3 blockchains are here that deliver scale, where you can have very large user bases. They're now very fast, low latency, and some of them have no friction. EOS is not the only one, but this is one of the ones that I'm pointing out. I believe another major trend that you're going to see over the course of the year here is own your own data. You know, we have our DNA, but we also have our digital DNA. And our digital DNA is all over the place. That digital DNA is, you don't even know where it is. You don't even know who's collecting it, when they're collecting it. They're collecting it in your bedroom. They're collecting it in your most private places, listening to your conversations and selling that data without your consent. We're moving into a world where our consent will be necessary, where we are taking back the ownership of our data. And that doesn't mean that we're not going to still be advertised to and all the things, but it's going to be done in a consensual manner. I think most of us believe that consent is important in this world. I think gaming is going to be a huge market for where this happens, where you're going to be seeing blockchain applications. I really love the idea of sort of augmented reality, you know, sort of environments where you're going to be able to go into an augmented Ready Player One. You're going to go find millions of dollars of buried Bitcoin and EOS and things all over the world. And this is happening right now with Satoshi Treasures and others. But we're going to start to see major things. Of the EOS VC funds, about 50% of the capital that's been deployed thus far has been investments into gaming deals. So if you're a game developer, iGaming, or call it video games, or what I like to say is the convergence of those, which is play to earn, this is exactly the time to be looking. The smartest game developers out there are building this way. You should consider it too. Another thing we're going to see is social, back to owning your own data. You know, I think the days of, you know, how Facebook has historically operated are coming to an end. Facebook even recognizes and agrees that this change is happening. But this is, you know, it's time for us to control our data, control who has access to it. And I think that's a big thing. We're going to see social sort of, you know, whatever 5.0 is happening. I think the same is true with messaging. This is my wife's company, Sense, which is provably secure messaging. If you haven't downloaded it, Sense Chat, provably secure on-chain messaging. Another project I'm focused on is Mt. Gox. I was very involved in acquiring Mt. Gox before its collapse and post-collapse. I got very involved in trying to clean up the mess. That's a big part of what I do. And it's now been in bankruptcy for 5 years. Gox Rising is an effort to create a new exchange under the same brand, but also to make sure the victims are taken care of. The Mt. Gox story is not over. This is our industry's Lehman Brothers. It is our story's Bear Stearns. And we have the ability to write the ending of this story, and we can make it a happy ending. And so we're focused on this. This is something we haven't really been showing, but a project I've been working on for 2 years, and I'll introduce it to you with some cool video.
ProxyCoin is a new film, television, and digital media company that uses blockchain technology to provide investors a unique opportunity to participate in the Hollywood film and television industry.
I want to hear your plan.
Using proxy coins, digital security tokens that will trade on global markets open to security tokens, the company provides each investor direct fractional ownership in a diversified slate of studio quality films and TV programs.
What you see?
ProxyCoin democratizes entertainment investing by providing most investors an unprecedented opportunity to participate in the frequently above market returns of major Hollywood productions with mitigated risk, exceptional transparency, and near frictionless liquidity.
No one has ever done anything like this.
To do this, we've assembled a team of respected financiers, blockchain experts, technology and AI scientists, along with some of Hollywood's most innovative and disruptive entrepreneurs and executives. With a combined 100 years of experience, together they have financed, produced, or distributed more than 400 films and some of the most successful programs in television history.
That's fantastic.
Our principals have taken a forward-thinking approach in pioneering some of Hollywood's most groundbreaking finance deals, like establishing new channels between Wall Street financiers and Hollywood studios.
Damn.
Over the last 15 years, ProxyCoin principals pioneered sophisticated slate and co-financing models that provided over $25 billion of capital to major studios such as Warner Brothers, Universal, and Sony. And we're also responsible for creating a new revenue window through a first-of-its-kind deal with Netflix.
Game over.
Our principals were also integral in structuring the financing arrangements that led to Marvel becoming a studio, allowing them to make their own films such as Iron Man, The Incredible Hulk, Thor, and Captain America.
I could do this all day.
But finance doesn't exist in a vacuum. ProxyCoin's principals have a history of success in selecting projects using both quantitative and qualitative factors. ProxyCoin will produce 8 to 10 films and 2 to 4 television series per year.
Short on time, so I'm going to just skip through the end of that. But the idea is security tokens, where is that market going to come from? I think it's going to come from intellectual property, specifically entertainment. And the idea is that we can take movies while they're in pre-production public with a Reg A offering, and so fans can participate in the ownership, gamification, all sorts of interesting ways that we can change the entertainment industry and turn it into a meritocracy, where we, the people, get to decide what content gets made, including things that are outside of the traditional studio sort of tentpole model. Another thing that's worth noting in the future, June 1st, June is coming. You'll see some pretty amazing announcements out of EOS, so stay tuned. As I said, summer is here. One of the theories, but something that you might find interesting, and you can look this up later, this is Pokemon. The character on the left there is Don, in the center is Satoshi. Most people don't know the character names, and obviously his teacher was Brock. And Nakamoto is a Japanese philosopher you may want to learn about. I like to talk about this, which is that a new definition of a billionaire is not someone with $1 billion, but someone that's positively impacting the lives of 1 billion people. I believe that we have an opportunity to change the game. And for each and every one of us, you should ask yourself, what are the things that motivate you? How do you measure success in your life? Do you measure success by, you know, the job that you have, the money that you're making? I measure my success in life by the positive impact I'm having, and that's how I prioritize my life. And we all have the ability to decide how we're going to measure our success in this sort of nonlinear game. And the idea is to go from a world of compounding interest to compounding impact. And save the bees, there's some honeycomb in there. We are in Malta, so let's talk about knights real briefly. You know, what are the codes of conduct of knights? Integrity, integrity. service-oriented sort of mindsets, but integrity, 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 we are in Malta. This is an 8-foot bronze sculpture of Hercules, and you can look up what the pillars and the U.S. dollar mean and things like that later. But the sculptor that makes this makes the largest bronze sculptures in the world, and the first one he did was of Hercules breaking the two pillars of the world. This one is Hercules pulling the pillars together, and it's called the Union of the World. We have the opportunity to create these win-win scenarios where the old and the new can win together. The incumbent systems, governments, Fortune 2000s. In an ideal world, this is an evolution where we all evolve together. We're not here to break the system. We are here to unite the system and evolve together. I'm obviously doing lots of stuff in Puerto Rico. If ever you want to spend time with me, this is the place to go. Everything is possible. We can make the world a better place. And I will close out with some Stephen Hawking's.
When we see the Earth from space, we see ourselves as a whole. We see the unity and not the divisions. One planet. One human race. We are not the same, but we are one. We are here together, and we need to live together with tolerance and respect. Our only boundaries are the way we see ourselves. The only borders, the way we see each other. We must become global citizens. Our voices are important. We give our elected officials their power. And we can take it away. Be involved. We are all time travelers, traveling together into the future. But let us make that future a place we want to visit. Be brave. Be determined. Overcome the odds. It can be done.
Thank you.